We're glad you decided to check out this message by Seabreeze Church and hope that you benefit from it. We also hope that you would join us either online or in person on a Sunday. We have a 9 o'clock live stream service online, and then we have in-person services on our campus at 9 and 10:30. So again, we hope that you would join us, and we hope that you enjoy this message.
Well, good morning. Welcome to Seabreeze. My name is Ethan. I'm the family pastor here. Excited to be with you guys this morning. We are in a series called Stories to Live By, as Elliot said in the announcement video there. In the series, what we're doing is we're looking at parables of Jesus. And Jesus, he told about 40 parables in total that are recorded for us right there in the pages of Scripture. Each one of these parables, it reveals truth. Each one of these parables is just packed with truth, some kind of truth that God wants us to know about who he is and then about how he operates. So obviously, we're not going to get through all 40 parables in this message series, but in each one that we do look at, what we're going to try to do is understand what is it that God wants us to know? What does God want us to know from this parable? Why would he include this? And what's the truth that he wants us to get out of it? And then on top of that, what are we going to do about it? What does God want us to do? So I'm really excited for the one that we're looking at today. The parable that we're looking at today is the only parable that I know of. I believe it's the only parable where Jesus, he not only tells the parable, he tells the story, but then he goes on and he unpacks the meaning of it for us. So let's dive in. We'll look at this in Mark chapter 4. It says this, "And he was teaching them many things in parables, and in his teaching he said to them, 'Listen, behold, a sower went out to sow, and as he sowed, some seed fell along the path, and the birds came and devoured it. Other seed fell on rocky ground, where it did not have much soil, and immediately it sprang up, since it had no depth of soil. And when the sun rose, it was scorched, and since it had no root, it withered away. Other seed fell among thorns, and the thorns grew up and choked it, and it yielded no grain. Other seed fell into good soil, and it produced grain, growing up and increasing and yielding 30-fold and 60-fold and 100-fold. And he said, 'He who has ears, let him hear.'" So notice as we read this, it's pretty interesting that it actually starts and it ends with the same thing. The very first word that he says here is "listen," and then he goes on to tell the parable. The very last word that he says is "hear." He says, he who has ears, let him hear. So it starts and ends with "listen" and this appeal to hear. But his disciples, even with this appeal to listen and to hear, they still really didn't get the picture. They were kind of left scratching their heads after Jesus told this story. And so afterward, they went up to him and asked him, "Hey, can you tell us, what does this mean?" And I'm really glad that they did that, because then Jesus goes on and here's what he says. He said to them, "Do you not understand this parable? How then will you understand all the parables? The sower sows the word, and these are the ones along the path where the word was sown. When they hear, Satan immediately comes and takes away the word that is sown in them. And these are the ones sown on rocky ground, the ones who, when they hear the word, immediately receive it with joy, and they have no root in themselves, but endure for a while. Then, when tribulation or persecution arises on account of the word, immediately they fall away. And others are the ones sown among thorns. They are the ones who hear the word, but the cares of the world and the deceitfulness of riches and the desires for other things enter and choke out the word, and it proves unfruitful. But those that were sown on the good soil are the ones who hear the word and accept it, and they bear fruit, 30-fold, 60-fold, and 100-fold. So we're going to try to understand this today more. But before we do, let's briefly identify who are kind of the main actors, who are the main players in this drama that Jesus is portraying for us. Very first thing we see is the seed. He says the sower sows the word. So the seed here is the word of God. This refers to all of God's word in the Bible, but especially it refers to Jesus's life-changing message that the kingdom of God, it's now here, and it's available for everybody. So this is the good news that Jesus came, and he came to restore relationship between God and between people. So the seed is the word. The sower is one who shares the word. The sower sows the word. So is that Jesus? Is that his disciples? Is that us? And the answer is yes. Anybody who is sharing the word is the sower in this story here, sharing the word. And then the soils. The soils are the hearts of the hearers. The hearts of the hearers. Whoever has ears, let him hear. is what Jesus said. This statement, it acknowledges that while, you know, one group of people, they might hear the exact same thing with their ears, that word, that message, is still going to land in very different places on different hearts. And this parable, this illustrates the variety of responses that the different hearers are going to have in their hearts to the word of God. So these are the actors, but then how do we fit into this story? What's our role? Well, first we fit in as the sower. Like we said, he could have chosen just to broadcast his message of the good news of Jesus. He could have chosen to do that and broadcast it without us, but instead he chose to enlist us and get us involved in spreading that message. And so it's valid for us to look at this story and put ourselves in the shoes of the sower and ask, how can I apply this parable as a sower of God's word? And next week, that's what we're going to do. This parable is so rich that we're actually going to break it up into two parts. And next week, we're going to look at how to sow. This week, though, we're going to focus on how to grow. We're going to, instead of looking at how to sow, we're going to look at how to grow. We're going to look at the soils, and we're going to talk about how they represent our hearts. And we're going to ask, how do I cultivate a heart that hears the word and then responds in a way that invites God to come in and provide growth and provide fruitfulness in my life? So we're going to do that by looking at each one of these hearts. And the first heart that we see is the hard heart, the hard heart. And this is illustrated by the seed that fell right there on the path. Now, here is a picture that was taken actually at my house earlier this week. This seed, it never really had much of a chance, did it? The reason it didn't have much of a chance is because it was sown on the concrete of my back patio. But then any chance that it did have, it pretty much dissipated as soon as this little house sparrow showed up. And then later his buddies showed up and seed was just gone. It really never stood a chance. And in our parable, this patio, it's kind of like the person who has a heart level built-in resistance to God's word. We read, when they hear with their ears, Satan immediately comes and he takes away that word that is sown in them. So for this person, Satan plays the role of the house sparrow. He is a seed snatcher. That's what he does. And we know how it is that a sparrow comes and gobbles up the seed, but how is it that Satan comes in and snatches up the word before it ever makes it from the ears to the heart? How does he do that? What does that look like? Well, his seed-snatching strategies, they don't usually involve well-thought-out argument. Instead, his best strategies, they involve making light of serious things, taking very serious things and just kind of making light of them. They're not strategies that cause us to consider God's word and then reject it. Instead, they're strategies that cause us just to dismiss God's word altogether, just kind of brush it aside and never really consider it at all. And these brush aside strategies, they can take several forms. And maybe you'll recognize some of these in yourself. I certainly do recognize them in me. One of those strategies is a scoffing, or we could call it kind of a mocking attitude. Scoffing or mocking. A scoffer is someone who shows contempt, but the way they showed their contempt is through insult or through making fun of something. And right now we live in a culture that really celebrates scoffing. We celebrate scoffing. Half the news articles that we run across, I'm sure you can identify with this, half the news articles that I see, they're not really articles anymore. Instead, they're just kind of compilations, more or less, of social media sarcasm, people's sarcastic responses to the news that's going on. And that's because our culture really just loves a good scoffer. We get into it. But Scripture pits scoffing against knowledge. It says these two things don't go together. We read this in Proverbs 1:22. It says, "How long, O simple ones, will you love being simple? How long will scoffers delight in scoffing? And fools hate knowledge." And there are plenty of reasons why someone might kind of throw up this scoffing smokescreen. It could be tied to past hurts, or it could be tied to past disappointments. It's easier just to kind of make fun and mock than it is to deal with those past hurts or disappointments. It could also be a desire for a behavior that God's word clearly opposes. Rather than deal with God's word putting limitations on my life, it's easier for me to just kind of write it off through scoffing. But whatever the reason is, if your impulse is to substitute scoffing for honest reflection on God's word, then there's a very good chance that you're playing into the enemy's seed snatching hands. Another brush aside strategy that Satan will use is just simply distraction. Just distraction. Nothing could really be simpler for him. Nothing could make his job more simple than to get us perpetually focused on very trivial things at the expense of ever focusing on eternal things. C.S. Lewis does a great job of portraying this in his book, The Screwtape Letters. This is a book where he's giving a fictitious account of a demon telling about his strategies for tempting people. And one of the things that that demon does is he tells about how he kept a man from contemplating serious things. Here's what that demon in Screwtape Letters says his strategy was. He says, "I once had a patient, a sound atheist, who used to read at the British Museum. One day, as he sat reading, I saw a train of thought in his mind beginning to go the wrong way. I struck instantly at the part of the man which I had the best under my control and suggested that it was just about time for lunch." Much better to come back after lunch and go into it with a fresh mind. That was the thought. He was already halfway out the door, and once he was in the street, the battle was won. Can you relate to that? It's a fictitious account, of course, but it really illustrates a powerful truth about Satan's seed-snatching tactics, and that is that if he can distract us from actually contemplating the merits of God's word just by getting us to focus on what is right in front of us, just get us to focus on that next meal, the next activity, the next news story, the next YouTube video, the next whatever it is, if he can get us to just focus on that thing that is right in front of us for 70 or for 80 years, man, he's happy with that. He would love for us to spend the years that God has given us just kind of focusing on one trivial thing to the next. Spend a lifetime being distracted. Satan is a seed snatcher. His strategies are often very effective, but God has the power to soften a hard heart. And God loves to come in and just chase those birds away. He loves to do that. So how can you invite him to come in and do that, especially if you notice some of these tendencies in yourself? So for each type of heart we look at, what we're going to do is we're going to look at one step, one strategy that we can have to invite God to come in and help us grow. And for the hard heart, the strategy is this: to cultivate growth by asking tough questions. Ask tough questions of God's word and seek answers. Now, a few months ago, one of my elementary age daughters, she came out of her room at night, and something was very obviously on her mind. And it took a little bit of drawing out from her, but eventually she asked this question. She asked, "Dad, how can I know that the Bible is real and not made up?" Wow, what a good question that is from a little girl. She asked that question, and this just kind of, we started talking about it, and what happened is this floodgate started opening of similar questions that she had. So we started talking about those, and this launched this multi-month process where we were asking questions, she was asking questions, and we were seeking answers. So we read books together, we reasoned together, we prayed together, and over time, she began to get those answers to those really clear questions that she had. As a father reflecting on this, I really admire the courage of my daughter not to just brush those things aside, but to actually deal with them. It's been a challenge to me, and I think it also provides a helpful model for anybody who wants to invite God to help them soften a hard heart. Specifically, my daughter did three things that Satan hates, but God welcomes. So here are those three things that happened. One is to articulate your questions. This is best done by actually writing them down. An ambiguous question is really a powerless question. But there's power in turning a vague question into a specific question. It's really hard to answer a vague question or just kind of a vague feeling. If you can turn that into a specific question, you can begin to get traction. So, what questions do you have? Common questions out there are, how can a loving God let bad things happen to good people? That's a heavy question. That's a good question. Hasn't the Bible changed over time? Don't we just have kind of some version? How do we know that what we have in front of you and the seat in front of you is the same thing that Jesus actually said? How can we know that? How can Jesus claim to be the only way to God when there are so many other religions and so many people who have never heard of Jesus? And these are big, important questions, and we don't want to let them be vague in our hearts. Whatever your question, don't let it be vague. Write it down and refine it, and then ask someone. Actually, include somebody. Satan would love for you to wrestle alone. He's not looking for a fair fight. Instead, what he's looking for is isolated victims. If you're wrestling alone, it just makes it that much easier for him to swoop in and snatch up that seed. So include somebody in your journey. And then read a book. Read a book about your question. My daughter and I, we read this book here. It's called More Than a Carpenter. We actually looked through several books, and this is the one that ended up being the most helpful. And it's the same book that we have out on the courtyard over here. There's a kind of a wooden box with some resources on it. That book is out there. And so if you have questions, I'd suggest go pick up that book. You can thumb through the table of contents and see, hey, is this attempt to answer any of the questions that I'm asking? There's also Bibles out there. If you don't have one of those, you can snag the book and snag a Bible today. But these are practical things that you can do to invite God to come in and break up the soil of a hard heart. The next heart is the shallow heart. And this is illustrated by the seed that falls on the rocky ground. Unlike the hard soil, this seed, it actually begins to germinate. It begins to grow. The problem is that the roots of this seed on the soil, they stay just surface level. The roots never really go deep. And because of this, the growth, it appears to be fast, but it's very short-lived. The plant, it can't absorb the nourishment that it needs for sustained life, that nourishment that would be delivered from a healthy root system. And so when the sun rises up high in the sky, when things get hard, when trouble comes for that first time, this plant, it withers. Here's what it says specifically. It says, and these are the ones that were sown on the rocky ground, the ones who, when they hear the word, immediately receive it with joy, and they have no root in themselves, but endure for a while. Then, when tribulation or persecution arises on account of the word, immediately they fall away. So this person, they respond to the word with a high degree of joy, like it says. But that joy, it just lasts until the first bump in the road. Maybe they make it a couple bumps in the road, but it quickly begins to fall away. And we've all done this before. We've done this with something or other. We get excited about something. We get really, really jazzed, and maybe we go out and spend money because we've got this new plan, this new thing that we're going to do. And then all of a sudden, things kind of start to get hard. We start losing steam, losing enthusiasm. Our excitement flounders, and the thing never materializes. I've had several of these things in my life, but I will tell you about the one that I think is the most ridiculous. I would appreciate if you don't judge me too hard for this, but I will tell you. So in my first job after college, I was 21 years old, my first real post-college job. I had to sit through what seemed like to me at the time some really long meetings. And these meetings, they kind of challenged my attention span in a way that it hadn't been challenged and stretched before. And so I now realize that they were just regular meetings and I just needed to grow up and be an adult. But to remedy my boredom, I went and I got this book called Braille for the Sighted, okay? Braille for the Sighted. Now track with my logic here, okay? So my plan was I was going to buy this book. I was going to learn how to read Braille. Then I was going to go buy Braille books. And then in these meetings where I was bored to tears, I would have the book on my lap. No one would ever know. Wasn't that a great plan? No, I'm not trying to defend it. I realize how ridiculous this is now. Foolish on many levels, but I was super excited about this plan, guys. I was going to be reading during meetings and no one was going to know. It was going to be awesome. Long story short, it did not work out. It turns out that it is very hard to learn Braille if you're not actually blind. And on top of that, I really had no plan. I had no strategy. When it was hard, I had no habits built in. I had nothing that was going to help me push through and actually add this skill into my life. So Braille was a total flop. However, there are plenty of other skills, plenty of other habits or undertakings in my life that have actually succeeded, that haven't been a total flop. And the same is true for you as well. We all have things where we've been really excited about them, but they've fizzled. And other things where we've been excited and we've actually succeeded. So what's the difference? What's the difference between those two things? One big difference is whether or not we actually form new habits around that thing. Forming habits is critical for turning initial excitement into lasting change. And so with Braille, my enthusiasm was like a 9 out of 10. But my habit development was somewhere around a 2 out of 10. And that even might be generous. It might have been more like a 1. And the result was predictably that I cannot read Braille today. Similarly, when it comes to growing in our walk with God, we need more than just this initial enthusiasm or excitement about God's word if we're going to experience this lasting change. We must add to that, we must cultivate growth by forming new habits. Forming new habits. Forming new habits is like developing a root system that allows us to tap into this life-sustaining nourishment that God wants to send our way. God wants to send resources to new life. He doesn't want to see a seed flounder and die. He wants to send the resources that it needs for growth. And there are two types of habits in particular that really plug us in to these resources that God has for us. One of those is habits of time in God's word. Time in God's word. The habit of spending time in God's word, it revolves around a daily routine of the Bible, Bible reading, and of prayer. There's no strict rules that need to be followed for this. There's not. It has to be done this way and no other. It could involve habits of memorizing God's word, trying to memorize verses from the Bible. It could involve studying verses from the Bible, but at its simplest, it means just reading the Bible and praying about what you've read. And then as you do this over time, what will happen is that you will form a more and more accurate picture about who God is and about how he wants us to respond to the storms and to the droughts of life. So time in God's word, and then also time with God's people. This is the other habit, category of habits. God sends many of the resources that we need for growth through his people, through his church. But often we just kind of like doing our own thing. We like to do our own thing and just be minimally connected to God's people. The problem with this is that when trouble comes, we find that we have an underdeveloped connection to God's people. That root turns out it's really shallow. And what could be just a rush of resources from God when we need it the most, instead, there's only a trickle. So now is the time to develop habits of spending time with God's people. If you feel that this root system is underdeveloped for you, then ask yourself, what is one habit that I could put on my calendar? And it would need to show up on your calendar because that's where habits actually take place. What's one habit I could put on my calendar that would help me connect to God's people? Now, I want to be clear, there's no habit that we can implement that guarantees growth. God is the only one who can give growth. I want to be clear about that. But just as roots, what they do is they search out into the earth. They're seeking out water. In the same way, these habits are a way that we can reach out and we can seek God. When we routinely show up just day after day in God's word, when we spend time with God's people, when that's built into our calendar, we're declaring to God, God, I am not content with a shallow heart. Please come in and grow my faith. The next heart is the crowded heart. The crowded heart, and this is illustrated by the seed that falls among thorns. Here's what we read. And others are the ones sown among thorns. They're those who hear the word, but the cares of the world and the deceitfulness of riches and the desires for other things enter in and choke the word, and it proves unfruitful. So notice how this soil here, this is different from the prior two. The first one, that seed, it just kind of dies on contact. The second seed, it starts to grow, but then it withers. With this third one, we're actually never told that the growth starts to wither. Apparently, this seed begins to grow, and it actually kind of looks just like any other plant, except there's one distinguishing factor, and that's this, that it proves unfruitful. It proves unfruitful. Harvest time comes, and you wait and wait and wait, but it never produces fruit. Other than that, it pretty much blends in with the rest of the plants. So what causes this lack of fruitfulness? The thing is, it's just too crowded. It's just too crowded. There isn't room for the weeds and the healthy plant to coexist. And so the weeds, they crowd and they choke out and they prevent that fruitfulness. This happens when a person receives God's word, but they never weed the garden. They like God. That's why they received the word in the first place. And they probably like his ways. They see a lot of good in God's ways, but they also like their old way of living. There's an appeal with that too. And they're not sure that they want to actually give that up. They think that maybe, just maybe, the word and the weeds can coexist together. And the result of that thinking is that the good that God would willingly come in and do in their life and through their life, that just never materializes. So what are these weeds? What are the weeds that can do so much damage? Well, Jesus, he calls them out by name, and here's what we see. One of the weeds is worry. He talks about the cares of this world, the things that weigh us down, that we're concerned with, that stress us out, the worry, the cares of this world. Another is the wants. These are the things, just desire for other things, is what he says, things that we want. And then there's wealth. Wealth, he calls it the deceitfulness of riches. And it's this middle one, wealth, that really binds all three of these together. These aren't just disconnected things, and wealth kind of pulls them together. And notice how it's not just riches. He calls it the deceitfulness of riches. Riches are deceitful because they make false promises. And those promises, they're related to the other two. They're related to our worries and to our wants. We all have things that we want to avoid, things that stress us out. And wealth says, you know what? With enough of me, you can avoid all that. All those things that stress you out, I'll take care of those if you have enough of me. And then wealth says, all those things that you want, well, enough of me, and you can have all those things. So wealth makes these claims, but it can't deliver on them. So how do we keep our growth from being undermined by these weeds, by these false promises? Well, we do it by cultivating growth, by changing old values. We change old values. Our values, what I mean by values is simply what's important to us, the things that are important to you. They're the things that take up energy and attention in our lives, and they're really the things that are important enough to us to devote resources to them. So if there's something in your life, whether good or bad, and you're giving resources to it, your time, your money, your attention, your thought life is devoted around something, then there's a pretty good chance that's something that you value highly. And just as weeds, what they'll do is they'll compete with the plant for the resources that are there in the soil. In the same way, when we respond to God's word, we find that these old values, now they're in competition with the new values that God wants to grow up in us. And there's not enough room for both of them. There's not enough resources for the old values and for the new values. But swapping out values is a difficult thing. It's really easy for me to put this on an outline, you know, change old values. It's really easy for you to fill in the blank on that, change old values. But when it comes to actually changing them, that's a really tough thing to do. Often we don't even know what our values are. And even if we did know what they were, we really wouldn't know how to go about changing them. And that's why we really need God's help on this. But the way that God often helps is by bringing situations into our lives where we must choose between our old values, those old values that revolve around worries, wants, and wealth. We must choose between those and his values. And this is called values sorting. Value sorting. It's usually something that involves situations that we would rather avoid, that we would rather just kind of not walk through, but that God brings into our lives as a part of his growth plan for us. In 2016, I recall a specific values sorting situation that God brought into my life. And the situation was this. My wife and I, we're both California kids, but we were living in Texas for 4 years at the beginning of our marriage. I was working just kind of a marketing job, and we were a part of a leadership training program at the church that we were going to out there in Texas. And when we joined this training program, one of the things that we agreed to was to go on an overseas mission trip at some point in the next couple of years. So we agreed to do that, fair enough. But then when the time actually came for us to go on a 10-day trip to Germany, man, I really did not want to go. I was like dead set against it. Right now, that sounds super fun. If you invited me to go on a mission trip for 10 days with some of you guys and my wife to Germany, let's go. That sounds great. At the time, I really did not want to do it. And I overreacted. I got angry and I got bitter. basically because even though I had volunteered to do this, I was just mad that I had obliged myself to do something that I really didn't want to do. And looking back, there are a pretty clear three reasons why I didn't want to do this thing. And it's almost startling how closely these three reasons align up with worries, with wealth, and with wants. So let me take you back and let me show you my Ethan's 2016 values sort. Here's what was going on in my head. The first value that I had corresponded with worry. I was worried because we had a 1 and 2 year old daughter, and you know, we'd left them for a day or two at this point, never for anything like 10 days. So I was worried about going crossing an ocean with my 1 and 2 year old daughter still at home and my wife and I far away. And then on top of that, there's also just the stress of figuring out the childcare for that. I didn't want to go through the worry and the stress of figuring that out and putting my wife through that as well. And so that was a worry. That was a very high value for me in this instance. Wealth. I wanted to keep as much of my money as possible. That was my value. We did not have a lot of money at the time. This was probably the closest thing to poor that we've ever been. And so we things were really tight. And I just did not want to go through the expense that I'd have to contribute toward going on this trip. I wanted to keep as much of my money as possible. Very high value. And then once. This had to do with my vacation time. It was going to cost 50% of my vacation time for the year, and that includes sick and vacation. So 50% of my time off was going to go toward this. Basically, it meant that if I went on this trip, I wasn't going to take a vacation in 2016. And I really wanted, those were my vacation days. I worked hard for those. I wanted to keep them, and I wanted to do what I wanted to do with them, not go and serve somebody else with my vacation days. So these were very high values for me in this instance. And then somewhere below all of these were the things that were more important to God. Somewhere below all of these was trusting God. Actually trusting God that if I kept my commitment with a good attitude, that he was going to bless me. I didn't value serving others. This was a mission trip. We were actually going to go do some good stuff. That was not a very high value for me. Following my leaders, honoring God with my attitude. You know, these are all things that I like that I would give lip service to. But in this specific instance, they weren't outranking the worries, the wants, and the wealth. And I knew this was my values ranking. I knew that my values were inconsistent with God's, but it was pretty clear that I had a choice. My choice was I could either double down on these values and say, God, no, I'm sticking with what's important to me, or I could allow God to complete this weeding project in my heart. And it's a scary thing to double down against the God who made you. I did not want to do that. And so I chose to admit to myself and admit to my wife, because you can't hide a bad attitude like that from your wife. So I had to admit to myself and admit to my wife that my values were just way off, and that I needed to recalibrate them to match God's. So this is just one example of God's weeding program at work in my life. And so I'd ask, what about you? Has God brought any value sorting situations into your life? Is there anything in your life where if you're honest, you know that your values, they're X, Y, Z, but you're pretty sure that God's values are A, B, and C? If there's not something like that in your life right now, I would say probably just wait a little bit, because these things come up. And when they do, resolve to let God complete and do this weeding project in your heart and submit your values to his. So to recap our soils here, the first soil, the seed, it dies on the spot because the heart is hard. The second soil, it germinates, but it withers because the heart is shallow. And this third soil, the seed, it grows up but produces no fruit because the heart is crowded. The fourth soil, this is what God is looking for, and we'll close on this. It says, but those that were sown on the good soil are the ones who hear the word and accept it, and they actually bear fruit, 30-fold, 60-fold, and 100-fold. So with these growth barriers removed, the seed does what is natural for a seed to do. A seed wants to grow. That's what it is designed to do. That's what it should do. That's what a healthy seed does. It grows, it produces, it multiplies. In the same way, God wants to produce a harvest of good in you. and in me. And so today we've talked about how we can grow, how we can remove those growth barriers to receive that blessing that God has for us. Next week, we're going to look at the same passage, like I said, and we're going to talk about how we can sow. That is, how we can be used by God to pass those blessings on to others. Let's pray. God, we thank you for these stories. We thank you that you just relate to us in such a human way, a way that we can relate to. And God, thank you that we're not just groping through the dark trying to understand who you are. You came down and you revealed yourself through your son, Jesus. And so we thank you that we can know something of who you are and know something of how you work, God. God, I pray that you would remove the growth barriers that that exist in all of us and that creep up from time to time, God. I ask that you would help us to partner with you and take action that is inviting you to come in and unlock growth in our life, God. God, we want to be fruitful. We want to make an impact for you, and we don't want our lives to limit the good that you want to do in us. So I pray you'd help us to play our part. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.